Good morning, everyone. Welcome to hearing number 51. This hearing is on the human rights situation of migrant persons in the Bahamas. I want to welcome the state of the Bahamas for attending the hearing. And in particular, we have with us, we don't always have our foreign ministers, so a special welcome to the minister, Damian Gomez. This hearing was, in fact, requested by the Caribbean Institute for Human Rights, the Grand Bahama Human Rights Association, Robert Kennedy Human Rights, and the participants are several more listed than on my sheet, so they will introduce themselves as the time goes on. With me this morning, I have on my left former president of the commission and also second vice president, Commissioner Jose de Jesus Orozco Enriquez. We also have with us former president and actually rapporteur for the Commonwealth of Bahamas country rapporteur, Tracy Robinson, and we have on my immediate right Commissioner Felipe Gonzalez, also former president and indeed the rapporteur for the rights of persons of migrant persons. So several commissioners here to discuss this issue. We will give each of you 20 minutes to make your presentation, after which we will be able to make some observations and questions and hopefully have time to revert back to you. Please proceed with the petitioners.
Thank you and good morning, Madam President, commissioners, colleagues from the government of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Wade McMullen, and on behalf of Robert F. Kennedy Human Rights and my colleagues, I'd like to thank the Commission for its interest in the human rights situation of migrants in the Bahamas, particularly the rights of migrant persons and the protection of human rights defenders working on migrant issues in the country. And I would like to thank the government of the Bahamas for its participation today. Joining me at the table, among other esteemed members of our delegation, are Frederick Smith, Queen's Counsel from the Grand Bahama Human Rights Association, Pierre Palissien from the Haitian Organization for the Prevention of HIV/AIDS and STDs, and Diego Alcala from the Caribbean Institute for Human Rights, and Joseph Darville, also from the Grand Bahama Human Rights Association. Before I turn things over to my colleagues, I would like to begin with just a brief overview of the current situation of migrants in the Bahamas. On September 17, 2014, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and Immigration announced new immigration restrictions. Without introducing any amendments to the law, these policies came into effect on November 1st of last year. Despite repeated requests by members of this delegation and others, we have yet to obtain official written copy of these new policies and practices, and have been forced to deduce the full scope of these policies from public statements, news reports, and ad hoc government practice. At least until November 1st, the government of the Bahamas issued certificates of identity to persons born in the country to foreign parents. The immigration status of an individual's parents was not a limiting factor for receiving a certificate of identity. In many cases, the certificate was an individual's only document of identification, allowing him or her to work, attend public schools, travel and obtain foreign visas, and receive basic social services. However, according to this new policy, certificates previously issued by the state will no longer be issued or renewed. Now all persons, including those who had previously obtained a certificate of identity, are required to obtain and present a valid passport from their parents' nationality and proof of authorization to stay in the country. Again, as best we can tell, the government is now requiring all persons to apply for a new document of authorization to stay in the country called a belonger's permit. In order to apply for this permit, the applicant must submit over a dozen different documents, including official documentation of their parents' nationality. It remains unclear what procedures have been adopted to ensure a fair examination of all applications, as there has been no publication of the new rules, nor sufficient public education to raise awareness about the new requirements. Since the implementation of this new policy, the immigration authorities, along with the police, have conducted mass indiscriminate raids of migrant communities, primarily targeting communities of Haitian migrants and Bahamians of Haitian descent, and have collectively detained persons suspected of having irregular residency status. During raids conducted on November 1st, authorities apprehended approximately 400 persons, more than half of which were either Bahamian citizens or had legal authorization to stay in the country. Since the raids began, communities have complained of verbal and physical abuse by authorities, as well as discrimination against and mistreatment of women and children. The raids have resulted in overcrowded detention conditions that amount to cruel, inhuman, and degrading treatment. Detainees are regularly denied access to legal counsel, judicial process, and international protection regimes. They face summary deportations and expulsions and may risk becoming stateless. In a region where hostility towards migrants, and in particular Haitians and those of Haitian descent, is on the rise, we are thankful for the opportunity to discuss the current situation in the Bahamas in the hope that we may find a solution to protect the human rights of migrants in the country in full compliance with the government's international obligations. I will now ask my colleague Frederick Smith to further elaborate on the human rights situation faced by migrants in his country.
Thank you very much, Wade. Good morning, commissioners. Thank you for entertaining us this afternoon and allowing us to shed some light on the serious human rights abuses that are occurring in the Bahamas. The new policy leads to discrimination against persons of African and specifically Haitian descent. These are estimated at between 16 to 20% of the population, by far the largest ethnic group. For decades, Bahamians have been encouraged, often tacitly and at times openly, to regard many of the country's social challenges as resulting from the burden created by the influx of Haitians. It's called in the Bahamas the Haitian problem. An anti-Haitian prejudice has become so deeply ingrained in the Bahamian psyche that the terms undocumented, illegal, or Haitian have become synonymous. Since November, vast majority of the individuals deported without due process have been Haitians or Bahamians of Haitian descent. And the impact has been worsened by the government's decision to focus not on the source of illegal migration at our borders, but on established Haitian communities that have been in the Bahamas for decades. The Bahamas has a constitution. A good one. It has entrenched protection of human rights. The Immigration Act requires compliance with our Criminal Procedure Code and the observance of due process guarantees. Officers have the same powers as the police and no more. There is a presumption of innocence. The Act provides for signed deportation orders on very strict conditions and the right to an appeal and very limited deportation detention. There is only one legal prison in the Bahamas, and that is Fox Hill, under the Correctional Facilities Act. The Carmichael Detention Center, which you've heard so much about, does not exist in law. Unfortunately, there has been a complete collapse in the observance of laws, despite many historical rulings to the contrary, declaring the current practices illegal. The complete disrespect for constitutional rights has reached endemic and ubiquitous proportions. There is no legal aid. The justice is limited. Language issues are a great barrier. The judicial system does not provide a remedy to the thousands who are having their rights abused. Meanwhile, the government is portraying its actions as lawful when, in fact, the exact opposite is true. The enforcement procedures include mass raids, exercises, checks, roundups, and roadblocks, where civilians are made to show proof of their status on the spot and face detention and possible summary deportation. These violate the Constitution. Many are detained despite possessing proof of status in the country. And we also know of a Bahamian citizen who was detained and summarily deported recently. This aggressive approach has led to numerous cases of physical and emotional abuse. It has created a culture of suspicion, prejudice, and profiling in which an individual's right to freedom of movement can be breached with impunity if they are perceived to be of Haitian origin. Raids are often conducted at night. Homes are subjected to forcible entry, sometimes by heavily armed officers dressed in battle fatigues, striking fear and sending a warning to other Haitian communities. Those targeted often and regularly have their property damaged or destroyed. Homes are left unsecured and vulnerable to looting. And when the occupants are detained, violence is often and increasingly meted out to those who resist. Women and children are particularly vulnerable. In this initial series of raids, several small children discovered at home in the absence of their parents were taken into custody and held in the general population at the detention center without any special supervision. It took days for some of those children to be released to their parents subsequently. There is perhaps no aspect of this immigration policy which is more disconcerting than the further obstruction and continued denial of children's right to attend school in violation of the Education Act, the Constitution, and international instruments. Starting in September, the only children who will be allowed to be registered for school will be those who can show that one of their parents is Bahamian or a legal resident. Though the state has sought to deny that this amounts to an effort to drive children of undocumented Haitian migrants from the classroom, this is the inevitable result. Now, all persons born in the Bahamas to Haitian parents have been directed by policy and not by law to obtain a Haitian passport and or newly invented document called the Belongers Permit. Last month, the government, in reaction to criticism that it is unlawful to govern by policy, began fast-tracking through Parliament an amendment to the Immigration Act, which civil society has not had the opportunity to make comments on, nor have affected communities been given the opportunity to participate in. It seeks to establish a civilian immigration reserve force, which the minister may mobilize at his pleasure. It creates impediments to persons born in the Bahamas to obtain their constitutional right to citizenship. It creates impediments to travel abroad, even to Bahamian citizens. It provides for the establishment of a detention center outside the laws governing correctional facilities under the Act. It now creates an offense of harboring an illegal person. It subjects an offender to imprisonment for 10 years for providing housing, board, or shelter of any kind to an illegal person. The proposed new law actually culminates in the creation of a new species of person in the Bahamas to be known as, quote, an illegal person, unquote. Now, in the Bahamas, a person is deemed illegal through administrative determination just by the immigration authorities, without charge, without trial, without conviction, and without sentence, i.e., one is now presumed guilty in the Bahamas. The Immigration Department has now become judge, jury, and executioner. The proposed amendments are unconstitutional, yet they will be passed, they will be enforced, and thousands of persons will continue to have their rights abused en masse. I will now ask my colleague Pierre to further elaborate on the effects of the migration policy on the Haitian community.
Thank you. Since the new migration policy, the Haitian community is living in fear daily. They are in fear of those who are supposed to provide protection for them. They are in fear of being mistreated, beaten, punched, slapped, and kicked by immigration officials. They are in fear of illegally being taken to a detention center where they will surely experience cruel, inhuman, and degrading treatment. They are in fear of their homes being ransacked while they are detained. They are in fear of their children not being able to study. They are in fear of being deported to a country they don't know. In fact, many members of my community express fear for my well-being because I'm speaking publicly about these issues before the commission in the government today. Members of my community have told me about the Carmichael Detention Center, where there is extreme suffering. They experience verbal, physical, and psychological abuse. They have no clean water to drink and no proper diet, and this makes them sick. The dorms are so overcrowded that people are forced to sleep on the concrete floor or even outside with no protection from the elements. They have no opportunity for legal counsel and no way to communicate with their families. Conditions are very bad for women. One 19-year-old detainee was forced to give birth on the detention center floor without the help of doctors. There are no proper sanitation facilities. There are also numerous reports of sexual assault. Late last year, a senior immigration officer was accused of taking a detainee out of the center to his home and raping her repeatedly. In 2013, another officer was accused of raping a Cuban woman in the center. Members of the community are also afraid that their children will not be able to go to school because they will be denied access if their parents have irregular immigration status. This is a violation of the children's right to an education. I stand here not as a Bahamian, not American, nor a Haitian, but as a humanitarian on behalf of humanity, not for any country. It only happened that the largest concerned group is the Haitian nationals and Bahamians of Haitian descent. But every single migrant is affected by these governmental policies. Once again, I thank you for your attention to these issues. My colleague Diego will now speak to you.
Good morning, commissioners. My name is Diego Alcala. I'm the deputy director of the Caribbean Institute for Human Rights. We have been monitoring the situation of migrant groups in the Bahamas in recent years, and we'd like to call the attention of this commission to several areas of special concern. First, the commission has held that in the context of migration procedures, detention should be a measure of last resort. Specifically, under the American Declaration, OAS member states are bound to implement immigration laws and policies that are premised on the presumption of liberty. Immigration detention should only be applicable in exceptional circumstances for the shortest period of time, and alternatives to detention should be sought whenever possible. The principle of exceptionality carries even more weight when children are involved. Under international standards, unaccompanied minors should never be detained. However, as discussed, the migration policy gives priority to detention, which has a disproportionate effect on vulnerable persons. Additionally, the Bahamas, through its legislation and implementation, criminalizes the status of migrants. We're also concerned with the lack of appropriate procedures for screening of persons in need of international protections. Both the Inter-American Commission and court have reiterated that international law requires states to implement effective safeguards to protect individuals with a legitimate claim for refugee status, asylum seekers, those at risk of refoulement, and persons at risk of statelessness. Because there are no effective and consistent refugee status determination procedures, it is possible that the migration policies are also affecting persons in need of these protections. As investigated, the conditions of Carmichael expose all persons deprived of their liberty to cruel, inhuman, and degrading treatment. The lack of proper regulations in conformity with this commission's principles and best practices on the protection of persons deprived of liberty in the Americas, and the lack of access for international and national organizations to monitor these conditions are just two of the many factors that increase the pain of the persons at this facility. The recent changes to the migratory policy may also infringe on the right to the Bahamian nationality and may also put some at a risk of statelessness. Under Article 7 of the Constitution, a person born in the Bahamas to parents of foreign nationality shall be entitled upon application on his attaining the age of 18 or within 12 months thereafter to be registered as citizens of the Bahamas. We have gathered information indicating that among the population that has been targeted, detained, and deported, some had a constitutional right to be registered as citizens, and others have submitted the necessary documentation for registration, but were still waiting for the government to register them as citizens. It must be noted that there is a backlog of thousands of applications, many of which have been neglected for years or even decades. Additionally, the Bahamas is only one of two countries in the Western Hemisphere that do not allow women, and in some cases men, to confer nationality onto their children, thereby increasing the risk of detention, deportation, and statelessness.
Finally, human rights defenders in the Bahamas are confronting a hostile environment that put their security and work at risk. Members of our delegation have been threatened for expressing their opinion against the recent changes in migration policies. Also, high-level government officials have made expressions against them, minimizing their work and even depicting it as alarmist and inflammatory. They have also threatened Mr. Smith and Mr. Darville with charges of criminal libel and sedition. Members of the media have faced retaliation for being critical of the government, including our colleague, Luby Georges, with us today, whose long-running radio show, The Creole Connection, was just canceled days after the immigration minister called for an investigation into comments critical of the government that were made on his show. We are extremely concerned with a recent Facebook post by the press, cultural affairs, and information manager of the Embassy of the Bahamas in Washington, D.C., which he stated on March 18th that he intends to use every resource he has to go forward and press possible criminal charges against the delegation that sits before you today. The rules of this commission prohibit its states from engaging in actions of retaliation against human rights defenders, but also international human rights framework requires states to prevent violations against freedom of expression and specifically impose a duty to protect and guarantee the rights of human rights defenders to do their work. In conclusion, we respectfully request this commission to conduct an on-site visit to the Bahamas so that it can gather direct testimony and information on the migration policies and its effects. Include the information presented today in its annual report. Continue monitoring the situation in the Bahamas. Assist the Bahamas in designing and implementing a training protocol on human rights for state agents, including the role of and the protection of human rights defenders. We also request from the government of Bahamas to revise its migration policy in order to guarantee that it is compatible with the state's obligations under international human rights law, stop the arbitrary arrest, detention, and deportation until migration policy is aligned with international law, ensure that immigration detention is used as a last resort, and that the particular needs of women and children are taken into consideration. Allow independent international monitoring at Carmichael. Ensure that the right of children to an education is not dependent upon the migratory status of the parents. Engage with civil society in a constructive dialogue to jointly address the problems affecting the Bahamas. And finally, address the inequalities and its nationality laws in order to reduce the risk of statelessness. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Before I hand over, I would like to make a correction. I appreciate now that the Honorable Minister is the Minister of State for Legal Affairs of the Bahamas and not the Foreign Minister. I want to assure you that I have no powers to reshuffle the Cabinet, so you will remain the Honorable Minister of State. But I also feel it necessary to pick up on something that the petitioner said in relation to possible threats and to just reiterate that at this Commission, we make it clear that our rules and our old ethos would not tolerate any reprisals or acts of intimidation against any petitioners or any persons who appear before us. And we have had on occasions in hearings to state this publicly. So we state it again just for the benefit of all concerned that this is certainly something that we would take seriously if an event does happen. Having said that, I now turn over to the state for their presentation.
Good morning, Madam President, and most distinguished members of the Commission. My name is Damien Gomez. I am the Member of Parliament for Central and South Eleuthera. I am also Minister of State for Legal Affairs, and it is in that capacity that I appear before you today, leading the delegation of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. At the outset, it is our distinct pleasure and my privilege to repeat the extension to the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights of the open invitation of the government of the Bahamas to visit the Commonwealth of the Bahamas at such times as are convenient to the Commission and at such periods of notice as the Commission deems appropriate. This repeated invitation is substantive evidence of the Bahamas' commitment to its transparent adherence to democratic norms such as the rule of law and constitutionalism. We pride ourselves as an example of the democracy in action and relish the opportunity to further engage in the wider international cooperation for the global attainment of universal adherence to the promotion of the enjoyment of human rights. It is also with great pleasure that we acknowledge the sterling academic reputation of not only you, Madam President, but other members of the Commission. And it is in that capacity, as regional academics and champions of human rights, that an invitation is extended to you at a personal level to forge relationships with other academics at the College of the Bahamas in its transformation to the University of the Bahamas. The deepening of regional sensitivity to human rights and the understanding thereof depends in large measure upon a vibrant intellectual debate across cultures and borders. It is our hope that the norms embraced by the Bahamas will have universal acceptance in our region, irrespective of language, culture, creed, or legal system. Our appearance before you ought to be viewed not merely as a court or commission appearance, confined, as it were, to the four corners of the petitions, which is the strict subject matter of this hearing. The general public are aware of these proceedings, which are being streamed live on the internet. The general public are aware through press releases and public commentary emanating from at least one of the petitioners. And it is in that context that we regard statements made outside of the precincts of this hearing today, and in some way inferentially drawn into this conversation this morning by the allegation that threats have been made against persons who appear before you. At the outset, let me say that the government of the Bahamas is not party to any such threats, though it is my duty to make reference to some rather outlandish and bizarre allegations which have been made about the Bahamas, which may well have colored some of the public statements private citizens may have made individually to members of the petitioners. And we stand ready to defend their right to free speech, that is the petitioners, and those persons who would have expressed themselves to the petitioners. But the false, baseless, and malicious allegations made against the Bahamas and its people is deserving of a response. Our history of respecting human rights predates our independence. Indeed, our support of Haiti and its people in the attainment of economic, political, and social stability emanates from an abiding and unflinching belief in the dignity of our shared human condition. Madam President and most distinguished commissioners, it is with pain that I must refer to allegations written and spoken by one of the petitioners before you. They have, as boldly as the falsity of their allegation, asserted that the government of the Bahamas has embraced fascism and Nazism in a targeted campaign to commit genocide against Haitian nationals. They even maintained that there are concentration camps in the Bahamas and compared the detention center to Auschwitz. These lies cannot be left unanswered. It is my solemn duty to protect the name and reputation of our people. That really is the sole purpose of my attendance here today. Let not my good manners detract from the depth of outrage collectively felt by the people of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas at the defamation of our country. In 1648, the original English settlers of the Bahamas arrived to establish a free society in which they might practice their religion without let or hindrance of the English crown or the Church of England. They settled on the island of Eleuthera, the Greek word for freedom. Shortly after settlement, a large number of black slaves were deported from Bermuda to Eleuthera, where they were immediately freed. Without a royal permit, the settlers pursued the establishment of their New Jerusalem. They held democratically elected assemblies well before the Bahamas became recognized by the English crown as a colony to be kept, whereupon letters patent were issued and our democracy institutionalized. The common law protected human rights. Much later, in 1963, a Bill of Rights was enshrined in the second written constitution affecting the Bahamas. In 1969 and 1973, two further constitutions sought further to explicitly protect human rights by repeating the 1963 Bill of Rights. In colonial and post-colonial times, human rights has been an essential feature, not only of Bahamian law, but also of Bahamian culture. It is in this context that the public utterances of the petitioner has evoked outrage and contempt as openly expressed by ordinary members of the public. We join the public in condemning the outlandish and bizarre allegations made by the petitioners about the people of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas. Madam President, distinguished commissioners, while we condemn the utterances, we embrace the petitioners in the Christian love and charity that we are accustomed to. As the Minister of Legal Affairs, it is part of my duty to ensure that any breach of the criminal law is visited with a response from the state. Should members of the petitioners feel that their lives or their health has been in any way endangered, and they wish to make a complaint, they are free to do so, and we will enforce the laws of the Bahamas in the ordinary course of things. We protect human rights, we enforce our criminal laws, and we do so out of a duty that emanates from law. Turning now to the petition, we point out immediately that the petitioners have failed to identify a single victim of human rights abuses in the Bahamas or a single failing in our domestic judicial institutions to provide adequate redress. But we appear as Portia to demonstrate the purity of our response to the demands of upholding human rights in good and bad times when even our closest neighbors failed to respond. With your leave, Madam President, I would like to refer to the photographs which we have furnished for the Commission, which show the safe house at which children with their mothers are kept while awaiting being deported back to their country, and also pictures of the dormitory, which has been recently constructed at over a cost of $1 million by the government of the Bahamas in response to complaints, not merely of the petitioners, but of persons generally about the conditions at the detention center. I'll continue until those photographs become available. But we ask you to note the bunk beds and the state-of-the-art bathroom and toilet facilities. These are hardly evidence of a concentration camp, much less Auschwitz. Note also the furniture and facilities at the safe house rented from the Catholic Archdiocese of Nassau and the Bahamas. Would the Catholic Church satisfy the petitioners as part of civil society? Here, the Catholic Church is participating in a private-public partnership to protect young people. Would the Catholic Church partner with purveyors of genocide? I think not. Yet this is what, in private utterances, the petitioners would have the public believe. The petitioners allege that Haitians are singled out. Our public records show otherwise. The government of the Bahamas acts even-handedly in respect of the enforcement of our laws. There is no racial or ethnic preference or bias. The figures tell the truth, and we will refer to the charts in due course. Our national security agencies have collected intelligence about the smugglers of illegal migrants from Haiti. It is reported that the fee charged each migrant ranges from $1,500 to $5,000. The criminal enterprises of human trafficking and smuggling is a new scourge to our country. It poses new risks to the Bahamas. These risks require a measured response to ensure that our laws are enforced and obeyed by all. The witting or unwitting comfort given by the petitioners to these criminal enterprises is noted with deprecation. Our duty is to govern, and that is what we intend to do. We cooperate with the international community in the fight against both human trafficking and terrorism. Law enforcement requires that we know and account for all aliens in our jurisdiction as far as is humanly possible. This is consistent with existing law and the amendments to the Immigration Act now being debated in our parliament. Our duty to govern also embraces our responsibility to give substance to constitutional rights enjoyed or to be enjoyed by subjects of our commonwealth. Hitherto, the passage of the amendments soared. Children who are natives of the Bahamas but born to foreign parents enjoy no right to remain in the Bahamas during their infancy or minority. At 18 and until their 19th birthday, they have a right to apply for Bahamian citizenship. The amendments which are being debated, when passed, will improve upon the situation of such persons. The amendments confer a status of belonger upon such natives, enabling those children to enjoy a legal right to remain in the Bahamas, to pass and repass into and out of the Bahamas, to attend school, to attend college, to attend university, as if they are full citizens of the Bahamas. Additionally, such persons may work without obtaining a work permit. The only right not enjoyed by such persons is the right to vote. In essence, the belonger status is akin to permanent residence with the right to work. That is a million times more of a benefit to the thousands of persons who were born in the Bahamas to foreign parents. We are completely awestruck that these salutary changes to the law of immigration are being questioned when all that we are seeking to do is to ensure that these persons are enabled to live regular, normal lives without fear, without let, without hindrance. Suddenly, when these laws are passed, such persons who now cannot open a bank account will be able to open a bank account. Such persons will be able to participate in the formal economy in a way that they have previously not been able to do. And yet, we are here and we are being criticized for attempting to ameliorate the condition of the very people who the petitioners are claiming to represent. Far from fascism or Nazism, we seek the embrace of our brothers and sisters born in our midst to foreigners who have made varying degrees of contribution to our development. Many of these people are of Haitian descent, but many also are of other nationalities and ethnicities. Many of these people are poor, but some of these people are well-to-do or rich. We seek the inclusion of all of their talents, recognizing that the Bahamas benefits by that inclusiveness more than it loses. Madam President and distinguished commissioners, we in the Bahamas have faced illegal migration for longer than we have enjoyed independence. Throughout this experience, we have extended Christian charity to the weakest amongst us, infants, children, young persons, the aged, the sick, and the infirm. We have provided schools and education even granting it as a legal right irrespective of the immigration status of the child. We have provided health care irrespective of a person's immigration status, and we have done so for, among other reasons, to promote public health and to prevent the spread of communicable diseases. Our history of inclusion is now being questioned in spite of consistent public statements from the ministers of immigration, education, health, and social services. This Bahamian tradition is questioned in the face of publicly disclosed expenditures and budgetary data, which demonstrates the commitment of the Bahamas to the creation of a democratic, great, and socially fair society. There is no threat to any child in the school system that he or she will be deprived of an education while within the Bahamas. Nor is there any threat to any immigrant that he or she will be denied medical care. Simply, there is no basis for the defamatory petition brought by the petitioners. And in closing, Madam President and members of the Commission, I meet with civil society once every month. It includes the church, and we have the Anglican Church and the Catholic Church in attendance. We have the Baptist churches, the entire array of the religious community attends on a regular basis at the Office of the Attorney General. Secondly, we meet with non-religious members of civil society, trade unionists, and other interest groups. We spend large amount of time discussing with the Bar Association and others questions about law and how it could be better fine-tuned to assure the public of the delivery of proper services. The government itself funds the Eugene DePuch Law School, which has a legal aid clinic. That legal aid clinic has been assisted by the UNHCR, which meets with the Immigration Department on a relatively regular basis, which participates in the training of the Immigration Department for the purpose of dealing with migrant rights and more specifically with the rights of persons to claim asylum. The country indication by the petitioners, quite frankly, contradicts publicly published documents such as reports by UNHCR. And that ought to be a cause for concern. We say that we are complying with our international obligations. We are open about it. We pride ourselves with the fact that we engage internationally with all forms of entities. And we do so hoping that we can improve upon what we do. There are times when we fall short. Yes, there was an allegation of rape against a Jamaican national recently. The alleged rapist is currently charged before the courts and awaiting trial. That is what a responsible government does. It enforces its laws. It brings people to court. Those persons are given a fair hearing. If they are convicted, they are sentenced. And when they are sentenced, they are detained in prison. That is how the system works. We are doing our best to ensure that all persons have access to justice and that they have a fair shake at asserting whatever right they may feel that they have. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Before I open the floor to my colleagues, I would just like to say that the Commission has not heard nor has been privy to any outlandish comments to which we preferred. We have not been swayed by any of these, any outlandish comments that may have been made. We have responded and agreed to a hearing out of a legitimate concern to interrogate an immigration situation which we believe may have important impact on human rights. And that is our only concern here today. So I would ask the Rapporteur for the Rights of Migrants, Commissioner Felipe Gonzalez, to open the floor.
Thanks, Madam President. And I appreciate the presentations done by the civil society and by the government of the Bahamas, which are very useful for the commission to get a better understanding about the situation of migrants in the Bahamas. I would also like to thank the government of the Bahamas for the invitation to do an on-site visit in regard to this situation. This is very important for the Commission on the issue of migrants and in general to be able to conduct in loco on-site visits and get a first-hand information about the situation on human rights, and in this case about the situation of migrants. I would like to point out also that as to make this clear that this is not a hearing about a specific precautionary measure. There have been comments on the measure both by the delegation of the civil society and by the government, and that is fine because that is one of the aspects about the situation, but it's not a hearing about the measure specifically. And I should add that when the commission grants a measure, it does so on the basis of a prima facie approach to the alleged situation, and it doesn't represent a definitive finding about the where there is a state responsibility or not, as when the commission is deciding on a specific case. So it's a different kind of mechanism that the commission has. It is very important for the Commission to continue to receive information about this measure that has granted from both parties so as to make further decisions and follow up on this. Now, as for the substantive aspects involved in this hearing, well, there is an issue that the Commission has repeatedly raised concerning some other countries of the OAS, and especially concerning the United States, which is the exceptionality of detention of migrants, that should be a measure of last resort in the same way that the UN bodies on human rights have stressed. In several visits to centers of detention of migrants in the United States and in several reports that the Commission has issued regarding the U.S. policies on migrants, it has stated that this should not be a general rule. So regardless the conditions of the detention, that of course are very important, but here there is some discussion about this, the mere fact that there is a large number being detained is a problem per se. Additionally, the Commission has also repeatedly stated that children should not be kept in detention, migrant children, which is the same that the Inter-American Court just said in its advisory opinion last year. The Commission, again in several visits to the United States, the last one in last September, made a clear statement that migrant children should not be kept in detention. And it's an issue that it's very pertinent in this case as well. Additionally, I would like to ask where do children are sleeping in this center of detention? I saw that there are some pictures of the female rooms were being shown. I don't know if the children are being kept there too. And I would also like to get some figures about the number of detainees, because one of the allegations made by the civil society was that there was overcrowding in the Carmichael Center. Additionally, I would like to ask about the access to justice that the person detained have. And finally, a few other points. I don't expect to get all the information at this hearing, can be provided in written later too. the issue of repeated raids of persons of Asian descent, the prohibition of massive deportations according to international law, and also the disproportionate impact that the new policies on persons of on Asian descent, that these new policies may have on persons of Asian descent. I would like to if you can elaborate more on this. And finally, for the commission and the reportership, it is very important also that policies on migration by the states of the OAS do not produce a risk of statelessness for persons. So that's a point I would like you to address too. Thanks.
Commissioner Robinson, Rapporteur for the Bahamas.
Thank you, President. I also want to express my thanks to the petitioners for the request for the hearing and the full participation of the Commonwealth of the Bahamas here. I've noted the invitation to visit and also the request that the Commission conduct a visit to the Bahamas. This is something the Commission will give serious attention to, and we certainly, whether it's a full delegation or some of us, there is a strong interest in seeing whether the Commission can visit, as the state has indicated. Just to say that we have been in discussions with the Bahamas. We have had an opportunity twice to meet with the Minister of Foreign Affairs and Immigration, and we welcome the continuing dialogue with the Bahamas. I wanted to ask a few questions about the Carmichael facility to start, and then some other issues, and to thank the state for the photographs which you have presented. There's some additional issues which I'm interested in finding out. The petitioners raised questions about abuse, verbal and physical abuse at the facility, and I wanted to hear the response of the state in relation to that. And I welcome that there has been an arrest in a case in which there was an allegation of sexual violence, but the state has a duty to exercise due diligence to prevent the violence as well, not simply to prosecute it when it happens, and to find out what measures the state is undertaking in relation to preventing violence and abuse at detention facilities or elsewhere by immigration personnel. I'm also interested in the due process rights of persons being detained and learning more about whether those persons have access to legal aid, whether through the Eugene DePuch Clinic or otherwise. I'm interested in whether human rights defenders have access to the detention facility for the purpose of monitoring and sharing information with others. Like Commissioner Gonzalez, the pictures can't reflect for us the question of overcrowding, and so we're very much interested in that data as well. We're also been told that language presents a problem for detainees in fully exercising their human rights, and we welcome any information on available interpretation. I then also want to ask about the immigration policy, which we understand is not doesn't yet have a legal basis. My understanding is that amendments to the Immigration Act would now provide a legal basis for that policy, but one of the concerns raised by the petitioners is that this would rely heavily on administrative processes for certain decisions about who is, for example, an illegal person, and we wanted to find out the extent to which the new immigration amendments would fully respect the rights to due process for persons who are affected by it. And finally, whether the state would be willing to have the opinion of the commission and to consult with the commission on the immigration law, which is under consideration. And then finally, in relation to human rights defenders, the commission, as the president indicated, is always concerned when there are allegations of either threats or stigmatization of defenders. And we ask the state to pay close attention to the allegations made. The commission also has very clear rules and principles about the use of criminal laws, including criminal libel laws, in a context where human rights defenders are exercising their rights to protect the interests of others.
Thank you. You may wish to put on your headphones, big headsets, because I'm going to ask Commissioner Orozco, who will speak in Spanish.
Thank you, President, and I appreciate that your comprehension, your understanding, I mean, in order that I will speak in Spanish. Sí, muchas gracias también a las organizaciones, a los representantes de las organizaciones peticionarias y a la delegación del Estado, y apreciamos el alto nivel de quien los representa, honorable ministro y excelentísimos embajadores. Como sabemos, de acuerdo con el derecho internacional, los derechos humanos son de las personas y no derivan de la condición de nacional de algún estado. Escuché que efectivamente las Bahamas impulsan y dan el acceso a ciertos derechos básicos, incluso a personas migrantes. Pero yo le preguntaría a ambas partes si también este acceso a derechos básicos, y me estaría refiriendo a protección a la salud, a educación, se le da también a las personas que tienen un estatus migratorio irregular, ¿verdad? A ellas o a sus hijos, ¿me explico? Esa sería una pregunta que nos agradecería se nos brindara la información o la aclaración correspondiente. Y solo ya mis colegas, el comisionado González, la comisionada Robinson, hacían referencia al acceso a la justicia. Yo también consultaría a las personas en un procedimiento administrativo o posible de deportación, ¿verdad? Yo le preguntaría también ambas partes, si también habría alguna, y con particular al Estado, acceso a alguna asistencia consular, y de qué manera garantizaría el Estado el acceso a la asistencia consular de las personas que estuviesen detenidas por estar en una situación migratoria irregular. Y en este aspecto de acceso a la justicia, consultaría cuál sería el recurso que tendrían a su alcance estas personas, y si habría la posibilidad que ese recurso judicial pudiera ser resuelto antes de que fuesen deportados. Muchas gracias.
I am also a bit unclear as to where policy stops and law begins, both in terms of, you know, the new act that we are told, the new bill that's before Parliament, and what exactly it will change. I'm sure that we will get a copy of that, but also in relation to the new policy stroke bill, how is that consonant with the existing immigration law and the existing constitution, particularly with regard to due process? So my colleagues said some of that about the due process requirements. When you are detained, what happens next? In particular, do you have an appeal and so on? All of these, and we were told that the Immigration Act already has those provisions in it, and of course the Constitution. And I reiterate what Commissioner Gonzalez said about the Commission's view that and international law's view that detention must be a last resort. So my understanding is that it's not a last resort, so perhaps you can tell us a bit more about that. I'm also concerned about the information from the petitioners that the new law will, in fact, criminalize, for lack of a better word, ordinary citizens in their humanitarian efforts, that you could in fact be prosecuted if you gave some sort of assistance, especially if we know that there's no crime has been committed, no even offense, certainly no due process at that stage. So that would be something that I think we would need some specific information on at the point at which somebody is suspected of being an undocumented person. If a behemoth citizen assists them, what exactly is the new law attempting to do? In terms of the enforcement of the policy or the law, how do you go about the process? How do you go about identifying persons who are, in fact, non-nationals? That, I think, is part of the whole concern, that there seems to be a sort of suspicion which may not be reasonable based on how they look or how they sound. You did indicate that you would give us some figures. I don't know if I missed it, but perhaps it would be given to us in writing. We will certainly be happy to get those figures, just to ensure and to reassure ourselves about the proportionality issues that are involved there. And what happens if you do detain, if you do stop someone and you think that person is on some sort of suspicion that that person is not a national and the person doesn't have their passport on them? What happens? What are the reports on that? What safeguards are in place to ensure that that person is not hauled off and deported or detained, as the case may be? Those sorts of enforcement, nitty-gritty kinds of issues. I also have an interest in finding out a bit more about the new policy in relation to persons who have one parent who's Bahamian and the other parent, I don't want to say foreign parent, because that parent might be Haitian, and we know as a member of CARICOM, I don't consider Haiti to be foreign. So I would just say a non-national parent. It could be any. I ask this because you did indicate that there's no right to citizenship. I understand that. But I also know from my own information, perhaps that's changed, that there's also a gender dimension in the law, that if it's a woman, for example, marries someone who's not a Bahamian, then they don't get citizenship. But if you're a man, I wonder if the new policy says anything about that or the new law will correct that. You said there'd be some benefits. So I wondered if that is also something that you're looking at and just how that will be played out in this new policy stroke law. Another question I had was about, well, I think I mentioned the figures already. So the last thing I wanted to note was simply to reiterate the concerns about statelessness. As you know, this is not a new issue for the commission. We had a visit 2 years ago in another country in the region, which was a very, very big issue for us. And we listened to many, 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 many sad stories of persons who were in effect stateless. And some of them wanting to get married, not just school and work, but I remember having people crying because they were about to get married and they couldn't because they had not just no state, but no status. So these are concerns that also remind us in this situation. We want to be reassured it's not the same. Just to say that we don't expect you to answer all of these questions at this hearing. There have been many, many issues raised, most of them directed at the state, which is not unusual for hearings, but that some of it you could give it to us in writing, or a lot of it you would give it to us in writing, but I just would give us 3 minutes each to make further observations, comments, and then we can wrap up. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam President, and thank you for the presentation of the state, especially the invitation for the commission to visit and conduct an on-site visit. We really welcome that invitation, and thank you so much. We're also grateful for much of the rhetoric about respect for rule of law and human rights in the state's presentation this morning, but would like to reiterate that when calling migrants illegals, that only furthers discrimination and stigma against migrants in your country. One last point, and then I'll turn it over to my colleague Diego, of just to reiterate the concern of the petitioners about reprisals and inflammatory statements made against those participating at the commission. And we thank you, commissioners, for expressing your longstanding policy of standing against those reprisals and for the participation of human rights defenders in these proceedings. Diego.
Thank you, Wade. Again, we thank the government for being here, and we are very grateful that this dialogue has begun at an international level, and we look forward for the commission to be present in the Bahamas, especially looking at the new facilities that the government has shown for the first time here. We are very hopeful that this the picture depicts a better situation. We do note that the overcrowding situation has never been previously denied by the Bahamian authorities. In previous statements, they have accepted that there is a situation of overcrowding in the detention center. The UN Special Rapporteur on Human Trafficking has also addressed the issue of Carmichael and overcrowding issues, but they all have also addressed the issue of refugee and the procedure utilized or the lack of uniformity in the Bahamas. We have firsthand experience with a particular case in the Bahamas that the individual may qualify for refugee status and is given through the immigration department recommendation to provide refugee status, but since the immigration and the foreign affairs ministry is within the same building, the foreign affairs would then override that decision. That has left a particular person in the detention facility and then moved back to Fox Hill and then back to Carmichael for an extended period of time. We do note, and we are highlighting the fact that when it comes to indiscriminate implementation, it has been widely stressed by the government that these exercises will be conducted in specific communities. If you investigate these communities, they're basically Haitian entrenched communities that have been there for decades. So it's not surprise to consider these as arbitrary or specifically designated to a particular group of members. Again, we thank the commission for hearing to our petitions. We thank the government for being here, responding to these allegations. But we look forward that continuous cooperation, that we open Carmichael, we let international observers come in, and we begin a process in which we can improve the beautiful country that it is, the Bahamas. Thank you.
Ms. Tate?
In relation to overcrowding at the detention center, my instructions are that overcrowding is situational. Currently, the center has 168 persons, 172 males, 16 females. The full capacity of the detention center is 500 persons. There's a refugee administration unit. And that's comprised of immigration staff, all of whom have language skills. They speak Creole, some speak Spanish, which are the languages most encountered. The staff are trained by UNHCR for interviewing purposes, and we have a history of working with UNHCR, particularly on refugee issues. As regards the information on that has been asked by the different commissioners, we will provide, subsequent to this meeting in writing, formal positions on those. In relation to the consular assistance that is routinely made available if someone's arrested for whatever reason, whether it be a breach of the immigration law or any other law, an ambassador or the embassy is contacted. The Haitian embassy normally would be conducted if Haitians are the subject of arrest. And presumably the Haitian embassy engages the services that may be available from the law school's clinic or from other sources for the purpose of providing legal assistance. in relation to the problems which we faced when dealing with this particular petition in terms of communication between the Commission and the Embassy here, I would like you to know that the head of mission, Mr. Chet Nimoy, will be the primary point person, and his immediate junior in that regard would be Ms. Tracy, what's her last name? Doristant. So that in future, whatever bureaucratic problems we have in responding will be cured by having those persons, one, be authorized to accept communications from the Commission, and being authorized also to communicate with the Commission subsequent to having been contacted. And that hopefully will address the problems which we've encountered in this experience. And we will supply the information from the Embassy in a short period of time.
Thank you, and we do appreciate that you're not often before the Commission, so it takes some time to sort these sorts of issues out. I want to thank all of you. I would like to thank the State for your attendance here. We do appreciate and value that very much as a sign of good faith and acceptance of the mores that ground the Commission and human rights, respect for human rights. And to thank you also for your assurances that there will be no reprisals. We expect no less from a CARICOM country. But you do appreciate that is something that we always have to safeguard against and make public statements on. I'd like to thank the petitioners for bringing this important issue to our attention, and we will continue to monitor the situation. We are also grateful for the invitation and the willingness to visit from the Commission, and we will continue to work and move forward on this issue. Thank you again. And this is the end.